Hundreds of movies are made every year, but only a handful of them are successful. And even less stand the test of time and are still popular 40 years later. One of those is The Warriors. And we have two of the stars here with us tonight, David Harris and Thomas Waits. And we're going to find out what it was like making the film, as well as what their career has been like since then. Because tonight, The Warriors come out to play. Okay, so great having you guys on. I've known David for a while, and Tom, I'm very familiar with your career. This is the first time we're actually meeting. When you guys first made the movie, it's obviously still popular with everyone today, almost 40 years later. Do you have a sense of how popular it was going to be?
No, actually, we did not. I mean, when we shot this movie, we all came together. It was supposed to be an 8 or 9 week shoot. We went almost about 5 months, I think, Tom. And we had no idea it would become this international cult classic. We just didn't. None of us did, I believe. And it is what it is today. I mean, but we didn't, at least I know I did not see that.
Yeah, Tom, what did you think? Because you obviously had some issues with it because you actually got your name removed from it. You're actually uncredited in the film, right?
Yeah, I got fired.
You got fired? I was going to say you got a lot of screen time for a guy who's not in the movie.
Yeah, it was. They say you're not really an interesting actor until you get fired. But, yeah, what happened is I got into disputes with the director because, you know, we were going to make a different kind of a movie, I thought, than we were making. And, you know, he didn't like me being a pain in the ass and asking him a lot of questions. But the fact is that what happened is they sent the movie to me and said, you know, where do you want to be credited? And I screened it, and I guess I felt resentment about being fired. So I said, take my name off the movie. And that really pissed a lot of people off. It was, you know, I'm going to write a book, What Not to Do to Be Successful. Do the opposite of everything I do, and you'll make it for sure.
That's an acting teacher talking.
That's
folks.
Right.
So do you regret that now?
I do. I do regret that. That was an act of egoism and selfishness.
And you were young, right?
And I was a kid. I was 23, you know. But, you know, in terms of it being a successful you know, I remember I asked Pacino once if he thought The Godfather was going to be what it became. And he was like, no, it was a low-budget movie that it was a job. We were lucky to get through it. No one had. And he almost got fired from The Godfather. Could you imagine?
No wonder you guys are friends.
Yeah. All great actors are difficult.
Deja vu.
Right.
Now, David, that whole Cochise look was a real interesting thing. Was that written into the script, or did you guys come up with that?
No, that was Bobby Mannix, a wonderful, wonderful costume designer. And I had a little input on it, but she really wanted him to be stand out as far as his costume and to be the most exotic warrior as far as his costume. And when I read the script, I said, no, he's got to look different from all the other guys. He's got to stand out. I want him to look like a black Indian. You know what I mean? I want him to look like the great Cochise that was in, you know, the 18th century. And so her ideas on the costume were just magnificent. And my little tiny input that I was talking to her about and what Walter perceived what Cochise would look like with his outfit, it all came together and it all worked.
You know, Tom, one of the things I found interesting, because I've actually just watched the movie again because I wanted to be up on things, it looked like you were kind of with the girl, the female lead in the beginning. Right. You guys were running everywhere hand in hand, and next thing you know, after your untimely demise, she right. ended up with...
Right, that was supposed to be the story, is I was supposed to meet this girl, and, you know, we were supposed to rise above the violence of the streets, and, you know, it became more about the violence, I guess, as
it was supposed to be Fox and the Fox, I guess, huh?
Yeah, it was supposed to be Fox and the Fox, right? Mercy was a fox. And, you know, things change. Creative process changes. It changes things.
For people who didn't understand my bad joke, his name was Fox in the film.
Right, right. You know, I was in Greece And Mykonos, a little island in Greece, and I was walking around with this girl that I was seeing around this village in Greece. And this guy comes up to me and he goes, "Hey, you were the fox in the Warriors, right?" And he high-fives me and asks me for an autograph. I mean, can you imagine, you know, that it was that far-reaching?
Yeah, I mean, everybody I talk to remembers the movie, and it's, we're talking 1979. Now, it didn't make New York look like a really good place, I have to tell you.
Well, back
I mean,
then.
One of the amazing things about the subway is there were like no normal people on the subway. I don't know why they even kept it going. There were like gang members and four people on their way to the prom. It was like the whole subway system. But you know what I was found fascinating, actually? You have the big gang summit in the beginning.
Right.
And gangs from all over the city are going. All these brutal gangbangers, they all paid their fare. See, they had the one guy with a handful of tokens, and as each one of them went through, he tossed one.
I never thought of that.
Well, they were being nice then, but if you look at the film, back in the 70s, back in the day, the way the city looked, it looks nothing like what it looks tonight. It's gone. The city's gone through a metamorphosis. It's the 42nd Street is now Disneyland. That whole area, but back then, the subway was full of these wonderful graffiti artists, and graffiti was all over the city. You know what I mean? And that look has totally gone. You know what I mean? It was all over the East Side, the Lower East Side, and the Bronx and Manhattan. But that look is gone. And that's one of the beauty of the Warriors, the way Andy Laszlo lit the film and the way Walter shot the film, is the look of the 70s, of the way New York looked. And New York does not look like that anymore. Well, you know, you have this sterile subway system. There's not one bit of graffiti in the subway system.
So you're
anymore.
A graffiti fan.
Well, I mean, it was art. Yes, I am. It was art.
Now, speaking of graffiti, your guy Rembrandt was tagging everything in sight, but did you get any flack from any actual gangs? Because there was some real graffiti, I'm sure, that they might have been tagging over. Was there any interaction between...
Well, one time there was... this gang didn't like us being down in Brooklyn somewhere. Was it Brooklyn?
It was up Spanish Harlem somewhere.
Yeah.
We had to leave.
And they didn't like us being there. And they made us... Because we were just a bunch of actors. We were not gang members, okay? I mean...
A lot of people look pretty legit.
Yeah. You know, we were pretty tough. I mean, we were all in good condition, physical condition. But I think the interesting thing about the look of it is that Walter wet the streets down before every shot, and so it had this kind of glistening effect. You know, that was very, I thought, almost like dreamlike or nightmare-like.
Well, it did have a very dreamlike feel, the movie, I thought.
Yeah. Surreal. It wasn't a realistic film. It was kind of like a...
Well, even some of the gangs. The most interesting one to me was the Baseball Furies. Mm. But people who haven't seen the movie, these guys are dressed in baseball uniforms, using baseball bats as like a martial arts weapon, and their faces were painted. Now, they were very reminiscent to me of Kiss, who were really popular at the time.
Yes.
Were they based on them at all? Do you know?
I don't know if they were based on them, but you looked at an old movie called Clockwork Orange.
Oh, yeah.
Which, you know,
forget that.
Thomas, for me, what you're familiar with, and the gang in that movie.
The Droogies.
I mean, I don't know if Walter based anything on that, but the Baseball Fury is just like something out of the Twilight Zone. You know what I mean? Whatever gang you ever saw like that in New York City or anywhere else, where they're dressed like that and they have their faces
pasted like that. A lot of
women
work
like
went into that look.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it was magnificent. The outcome was magnificent. I thought that it was very effective.
I think what's interesting is that, you know, this guy got way behind schedule and way over budget and got into a lot of trouble with the studio. And one night, I don't know if you remember, but we were shooting the conclave scene.
Yeah.
And all these suits flew in from Los Angeles, all the heads of Paramount. And there were all these limousines in Central Park, you know. And they put their foot, you know, they're like, why are we spending so much money? What's the problem? And it was shortly after that that I got fired.
Were you eating too many donuts? How did you go over the
Hey, take your hands off the catering. No, it's they fired the first AD, remember?
Yeah, I remember.
And then...
they brought a guy in from California that they thought that would really
keep
get the ship
moving.
The ship
movies
righted
are very
and
expensive.
Keep it going.
They're very, you know what I mean? Very expensive.
And he was. I mean, he was on his game, and... things moved along, but I think, you know, we shot so many scenes that you don't see.
Yeah, I was going to ask you guys about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff we shot. If originally, the movie does not start off at night.
I heard
but
it was in
see,
the beginning.
It starts off in the beginning.
And they thought it was going to be too stark a contrast from daylight to night or something?
I don't know the premises of that, but it starts off in the daytime, on the boardwalk, and blah, 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 blah. And then that all changed, and then we start off at night, right, Tom?
Yeah.
You know, there was a lot of stuff that we shot that's not in the movie.
It's fun seeing a movie in Coney Island for me, because that's not far from where I live. In fact, if I fall asleep on the subway, that's where I end up.
Is that right?
Yeah, last stop, right?
Still I could run into you guys someday. That could be a problem. Could I get any kind of gang material that I could show?
Tom?
Can I get a patch or something?
The gang was mad that we were walking around with colors. They're like, this is our territory. You know, you don't belong here. And we had to leave. I forget what happened.
That was the one you were talking about before?
Yeah. They tried to talk to them to, you know, calm them down. And they didn't want us there. They wanted us to leave. Mm. And we had to pack up. And, again, you know, movies are extremely expensive propositions. This is money that's being spent. The clock is ticking. And... that day they uprooted us from where we were shooting, and they had to rethink the whole deal. Finding locations, you know, there's a lot that goes into it.
Were there any real gangs in the movie?
Yes. Yes.
Who did you go
to? Well, at the big conclave scene, right. They went into the neighborhood because they had to fill that scene up with, like,
yeah,
I don't know, 1,500
people
or whatever extras, and they hired a lot. They went into... youth organizations and places to get these kids to work in this movie so they could shoot that big scene. I think we were there for what, Tom, two nights? You know, shooting
longer
that.
Than that.
Oh, okay. And
we were there for a week.
Oh, okay, a week. We were there shooting that one scene, and they had to fill it up with all these kids, and so they went into local youth organizations to hire these kids, and they gave them a box lunch and whatever dollars they gave them and a box lunch, and they get to be in this movie called The Warriors.
Right.
You know what I mean? But there were real gang people there, but they kept it under control.
Yeah.
I mean,
they were cool,
and so nothing like weird happened. You know.
Was there ever a situation where people who were in the movie who were actors were mistaken for gangsters? Or gang members?
I don't think so.
I don't know.
You know, we have makeup on, and they do right. Your hair. You know.
And they knew who we were. I mean, they knew who the Warriors were. It's these nine guys with this vest that said
well,
the
I
Warriors.
I don't mean you guys, but I mean anybody.
Oh, the other guy. Well, gee, God only knows.
Was there any problem with the police? Or I guess you guys had a full set of permits and everything, but
oh yeah,
had well, to take a look at a gang and start wondering if they were
no.
The real
I mean,
thing?
That's all organized and. Production people and all of that, and you know, with the city and the permits and you know, the police department, and that's all extremely organized and
it was a tough job. Okay,
yeah.
You know, you showed up at work at 5 o'clock at night, and basically the Warriors ran. We ran and ran.
You guys did a lot of running.
I mean, it was 4 o'clock in the morning. Let's do it one more time.
Yeah, how many times did you have to refilm? Because there was some scenes where you guys were running like full speed to the park and
just
stuff.
Just like Tom said, let me ask you this: did you ever see a fat warrior? No. You know what I mean? We were all in really magnificent condition.
I'm in the lead in every single shot. I'm the fastest one.
Yeah, he is. He is. He ran the fastest. I thought I would outdo him, but hey. He beat me.
A fox,
you know I mean?
A fox
you know?
Is a fast animal.
Well, right. That he did. He could outrun any of us. And the bottom line is that Walter knew when he hired us, he hired actors that were in physical good condition, and that he knew we would be doing a lot of running and fighting. And that's what we did in the Warriors. We did a lot of running and fighting. And I think he hired actors that could do this, that could pull it off.
Now, for the fight scenes, they were pretty intense. Did anybody ever get, like, actually hurt doing any of those?
Ha! Tom, Deborah?
Deborah
broke her arm.
That's the female lead.
Oh, yeah. Warriorette.
Well, there's really only one woman with a big part.
Yeah,
she ended broke up in two
her wrist, her arm, her wrist.
She broke her arm from her wrist to her elbow. She fell on the stairs.
Oh.
You know, she fell on the stairs and she's running with Swan, and she tripped and she fell on the stairs. And you see a scene when she has a pink top, and Swan asks her, "Would you get the jacket?" And she goes, "They're looking for a chick with a pink top." Well, that was written in there because she broke her arm.
Oh, okay.
And so they had to cover it.
Interesting trivia, Warriors fans. I actually remember that.
Yeah.
Is that before one of the five times he told her she was a tough chick?
I don't remember.
No, that was like a recurring line from him. And she said, "You said that before."
Well, anyway, she was a tough chick.
Was she? Yeah, she ended up with a big part in Too Close for Comfort.
She's a good actress.
Yeah, was she?
Yes, she's a good actress. Good girl.
Now, you guys made this movie around the same time as The Wanderers, which was a different type of gang-oriented movie, but similar enough. Was there any conflict there, or any concern about being confused between the two?
Well, they asked me to do The Wanderers, too.
Really?
Philip Kaufman asked me to do The Wanderers, so I had a choice of doing The Wanderers and The Warriors, and I couldn't make up my mind, so I had a couple meetings with Walter, and he convinced me to do his movie, which made me getting fired even more tragic. But, you know, it serves as a lesson. You know, don't be a pain in the ass when you're a young actor, you know. And if you have a problem, go to your agent and have your agent do your fighting for you instead of you trying to, you know, fight for yourself when you're 23 years old and you have no idea what's going on and you have a 3-picture deal with Paramount and, you know, these people are making money off of you. You know, get them to do their job. And if you have a complaint, if you have a problem, go to the proper channels, you know, to have it worked out instead of, you know, someone like me that tries to do everything himself.
How did you get the role in the movie?
Auditioned. And back then, nowadays, if you are called back more than 3 times, they have to pay you. But back then, they could call you back and call you back. So they kept bringing me back, and then they brought me back with Deborah, and we sat in Walter's office with Larry. And it was between me and an actor by the name of Alan Rosenberg, a very good actor. He was president of Screen Actors Guild. And I guess they couldn't decide. You know, they kept going back and forth and back and forth. And then I cast a spell on it. No, I'm just kidding. And then I got the gig, yeah.
I read somewhere that you, David, were the last one cast. Is that true?
I was the last warrior to be cast. I was doing a play in Minneapolis called Streamers. Great play. Great play.
David wrote.
And I we wrapped. And when I got back to New York, and my agent called and told me, he said, "David, Walter Hill's in town. He's got this movie called The Warriors. And he's got it totally cast, but there's one role, and it's one of the leads in the movie, and it's co-chief. And he's seen a bunch of people, and he hasn't cast it. But we want you to go up for it, and, you know, meet Walter and Lawrence Gordon and blah, blah, blah." And I said, "Sure, are you kidding me?" And I said, "What kind of movie?" He said, "Well, it's a movie about the gangs in New York." Okay, I never did a movie like that. It was my first feature. No problem. I went up, and I went up to Paramount, and I sat and I met with Walter and Lawrence. And Walter, you know, Walter kind of sits there, and he has a toothpick, and he has this wonderful thing that he does with his toothpick. You know, Tommy does that.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, his toothpick. And I walk in, and I was prepared to do 2 scenes. And halfway through my first scene, he just kind of looked at me and goes, "Go down a wardrobe." What? You know, I mean, I don't know. I mean, you know, first big movie. I ran out of there, and I ran. Back then, there were no cell phones, okay? We basically had pages, so I ran to the nearest phone booth and called my agent and said, "Well, they told me to go to Walter. What does that mean? I mean, I don't know, you know?" He goes, "You know, David, it sounds like you got a job." So I went to the wardrobe and I met Bobby. And then you know, I mean, I was cast as Cochise in the Warriors, and he had his cast.
Now, the heavy in the movie was David Patrick Kelly, who's been in so many things.
Great actor.
In fact, Tom, from what I remember, he came pretty close to shooting you.
Yes, he did, as a matter of fact. And he lives on the Upper East Side. He's still trying to shoot me. No, I'm just kidding. Is he getting any closer? He's a very exciting actor. In fact, he's in a play now called Everybody at the Signature Theater. Yeah, talented guy. Yeah. No kids anymore.
Just had a baby.
He's played in so many heavies. I've seen him in Commando and 48 Hours, Crow. What kind of guy is he really?
I think
he's just a scary character. But
he's an actor.
Oh yeah,
and he plays character scary kind of guys. But if you meet him, he's a wonderful, kind, soft-hearted human being. You know, Tom's an actor. I'm an actor.
Oh no, I know. You know, I'm just wondering what he was like.
He plays the thing thus. You know what I mean? He does what he does really well. But as a person, if you met him, he's a kind, giving human being.
He's a very good musician.
Oh, is he?
Yes, excellent guitar player, singer.
There are Warriors superb band?
There should be. Let's name our band the Warriors. Take it.
Hey, I'm for it.
Now, I was told that he improvised that famous, because whenever come I say out the Warriors to anybody, that's what they immediately come back with. The three bottles on his fingers,
yeah,
the Warriors
come out and play.
To play.
Yeah. Yeah. He turned it into a sing-song each, but that was him. He found that in the rehearsal room. We rehearsed for 2 weeks before we shot it. It just said, come out and play, and
yeah, he did. He improv that, and it took
It was so creepy.
It took us by surprise. If you look at when Walter shot that, and you look at the reaction shots on the Warriors, when David does that, it's amazing because he just blew us away. We did not know that was going to happen. We had no idea. We thought he was just going to say, Warriors, come out and play. But that set it all up. You know what I mean? For the big crescendo of Warriors, and his voice gets higher, the acapella is higher and higher, and you see the veins in his head popping. He's an actor. That's what actors do.
Yeah, he got quite a going over on the beach at the end. We don't want to give away too much. I'm sure after 40 years, there are lots of people who haven't seen the movie, like three.
Yeah.
Anyone who's forgotten the movie, I don't want to give it away. But the Cyrus guy, who was the main character in the toughest gang in town.
The conclave scene, the riffs.
In the opening scene of the movie.
The riffs.
Well, not the opening scene, but close to it. What kind of guy was he really? Because he's a very interesting, charismatic kind of character.
I didn't really know him. I mean, I've met his son, right?
Chris Hill, yes.
Chris Hill, and his dad was a great guy. You know, from what the kid tells me, and he was a wonderful actor, wasn't he? I
mean, oh, God.
You know, can you dig it? I mean, that's another signature.
Not Afraid of Heights.
Yeah, no, right.
It was a Shakespearean actor. And if you look at it, watch what he does. You know what I mean? It's Shakespeare. You know what I mean? You know, I mean, his whole mannerisms, his whole physical, what he was doing, you know, climbing up the ladder and this whole thing. He's a very... Thus saw the air, you know what I mean? Wonderful, wonderful person, wonderful actor, and just a wonderful, good human being. I got to know Roger Hill, and I was glad I was able to work with him and meet him.
All right, we're going to talk some more Warrior stuff, but first, we're going to take a break momentarily because a lot of people may not know, but Tom is also a successful musician here in New York.
Yes, I am.
And he brought a good guitar player with him, and we're going to come back.
Eric Warren.
He's going to do a couple of tunes.
To my right over here is Cool Daddy Eric Warren from the Upper East Side. Oh, yeah! And this is my music teacher, Stephanie Bennett. And we're called the Thomas G. Waits Project.
Okay, what's the you're going to do a couple of tunes for us. What's the first one?
First one is called In the City by Joe Walsh.
This is keeping with the Warriors.
There we go.
Featured in the film.
S-
somewhere out on that horizon, out beyond the neon lights. I know there must be something better, but it's nowhere else in sight. It's survival in the city when you live from day to day. City streets don't have much pity. When you're down, that's where you'll stay. Yeah, in the city. Oh yeah. Back against the wall, nothing grows here, life ain't very pretty. No one to catch you if you fall. Somewhere out on that horizon, out beyond the neon lights, I know there must be something better. I can't stay another night. Yeah, in the city. Oh yeah, yeah. In the city.
This is the Thomas G. Waits Project, and this is a song called Paradise. Count it. Lovely shadow on my window, tempting darkness luring me. All the beauty I've imagined finally makes a fool of me. I have fallen, I've been falling for, I've been fighting all my life to be more than a contender for a backdoor key to paradise. Interrupts this fantasy. All my hopes, they have been broken, disappearing like a dream. I have fallen, I've been falling for, I've been fighting all my life to be more than a contender for a backdoor key to paradise. Paradise, paradise. If I could only reach you, if I could touch your skin, if I could find the fire inside you, we might begin again, begin again, begin again.
distance. Come on, fulfill my fantasy. I know now that you are taken. Take my hand, girl, walk with me. I have fallen, I've been falling for. I've been fighting all my life to be more than a contender for a backdoor key to paradise, paradise, paradise. One, two, three, four. Baby, how I tried to fly like a bird with no wings way up in the sky. You always kept me on the ground. Now I look for you, but you're not around. Sweet darkness, swallow me now. Take me to the river, wash me inside out. Cover me with silence and hold me down. Sweet darkness, swallow me now. Too many maybes that turned to no. Too many places that we didn't go. So here we swallow me now. Take me to the river, wash me inside out. Cover me with silence and hold me down. Sweet darkness, swallow me now. They're haunted by certain names on sleepless nights. It don't matter, we go separate ways. Some defections just don't take, and some connections just don't break. Sweet darkness, swallow me now. Take me to the river, wash me inside out. Cover me with silence and hold me down. Sweet darkness, the sweet darkness, the sweet darkness, swallow me now.
Some pretty good tunes you got there.
Thank you.
You're going to be doing any shows anytime soon?
Yes, yes. On March 21st, I'm playing with one of my bands, the folk band called Old Kid, at Sidewalk Cafe, March 21st at 10 p.m., and it's free to get in, just a two-drink minimum. Then we're playing June 3rd, The Bitter End. That's the whole band. That's the Thomas G.H. Project, which Stephanie and Eric are, of course, part of. And then June 28th, we're opening for Vinnie Pastore at The Cutting Room. Mm. So please come out and see us. You'll have a great time. And plus, I take off all my clothes.
And The Cutting Room is an offer you can't refuse.
Right? That's right.
Yeah. Along with you taking off your clothes. Can we refuse that part? All right. Well, so you're a multi-talented fellow, but also, we don't want too much time go by without talking about your acting school.
Thomas G. Waits Acting Studio.
Big part of what you do.
TGW Acting Studio. It's the best acting studio in the city. It was voted the number one acting studio of the top four by Backstage. And it's the only acting studio, by the way, where I actually put people in plays, right? Nobody does that anymore except for Yale and Juilliard. I use my own money and produce my own plays so that my students can be featured, that is, showcased in, you know, roles in New York City. And that way agents and casting directors and producers can come to see them actually do it instead of just teaching a class.
All right, if somebody wants to get in touch with you, You got a website for the school?
ThomasGWaits.com. And plus, you can just find my number on any bathroom wall. Just
spray painted by Rembrandt?
Spray painted by Rembrandt. Oh, that's great. Let's take a moment and talk about Marcelino.
Okay.
Just an amazing human being.
He's the guy that passed away.
Who played Rembrandt, who marked our spot. Every time we went somewhere, you'll hear Swansea, Rembrandt marked the spot. And just an amazing human being and a multi-talented artist. And
the sweetest kid you could... He never had a negative thing to say about anybody.
Anyone. And
so we lost him way too early.
We miss him daily. And he was a very intricate part of the movie. And God rest his soul in peace. Great man. He's always there with us.
You guys seem like a tight-knit group. Have you guys worked on other films together? Are you and the other guys in the movie?
Remar and I have. James Remar and I have done 4 pictures together.
Right,
we actually did a movie before The Warriors called On the Yard.
I saw that on Wometco Home Theater, I think. If anybody remembers that, then they get 3 brownie points. You remember Wometco Home Theater? It was like on Channel 68 in New York when we didn't have HBO yet.
Sounds like the...
They show it for like 2 hours at night.
Right. That sounds like me. Late at night when nobody's around, let me in your living room. Yeah.
But the 3 of us that were watching really liked the movie.
Thank you. It's a very interesting movie. It's with the great actor John Hurd and Joe Grafasi, Mike Kellen. I mean, a list of character actors, as long as you're on Dominic Chianese, of course, from The Sopranos. And it's a prison film. It was my first picture. I was 22. And James had a part in that. And then James and I went on after The Warriors to do a movie called The Clan of the Cave Bear.
God, I love that movie.
You'll laugh. You'll cry. You'll kiss $20. Goodbye.
So, I love it.
Were you and Daryl Hannah a thing?
No, not a thing like that. I mean, you know, I loved her, and it was a tough film, tough shoot, and we had a lot of problems, most of which I caused, as usual. No, just kidding. Not me this time. It was a difficult shoot. But Daryl's, you know, beautiful. And, it was a great thing to get to do a movie with her and to work with James again. You know, we spent a lot of time together in Vancouver.
And you worked with Dominic, one of my favorite guys, who was a guest on my old radio show, in one of my favorite movies, And Justice for All, which was a pretty intense part for you.
That's right. That was another picture I did when I was 23 with, of course, Al Pacino, the great American treasure. And I did American Buffalo with him, of course, on stage for over a year. And to sold-out performances as well they should have been, because he was unbelievable to watch. He's like being with live electricity, if you can imagine such a thing. He is almost, it feels like if you get near him, you're going to explode from the intensity. But what a incredible experience as a young actor to do that 8 times a week. What training for my instrument and for my future. And, of course, he's been very good to me throughout the years. And, you know, we're both members of the Actors Studio. And, I've been a lucky guy.
Now, both of you guys, speaking of Injustice for All, have been in movies where you had a rough time of it in prison. You were in Brubaker.
Yeah, I did Brubaker. I did Attica.
I was thinking of Brubaker, which is one of my favorites.
Yeah, it's a terrific movie. I got a chance to work with, Robert Redford and Yaphet Kotto. And just an amazing cast. Conrad Sheen, who also did The Warriors with me. But one of my movies that I really, really enjoyed working with is that I worked with a movie called A Soul Destroy with Denzel Washington and Howard Rollins.
Norman Jewison.
Norman Jewison directed it. Denzel was just nominated for Fences, which he produced, directed at the Academy Awards. I've done some movies that I'm really, really very proud of that I work with. I've been blessed. I've been really, really, really blessed in scores of, television series, which has been...
Well, you were a regular on NYPD Blue, one
right,
of my very
right.
favorite
I worked
shows.
The last season of it. I did, you know, 16 episodes of it, and, you know, I was very blessed to do that, to work with Dennis France, which is just an amazing actor and the rest of the cast. Very well produced show, won scores of Emmy Awards.
Groundbreaking, really.
The whole Steve Bosco thing with, you know, Hill Street Blues, which was just an amazing series back in the 70s. You know, Stephen Bosco is an amazing producer, and got a chance to work with that whole company. And so I've been very blessed. Been very, very blessed.
And I saw Tom in a couple of great NYPD Blue episodes, too.
I did a couple of NYPD Blue episodes. I played a racist. Can you imagine?
You know, you told me that on the phone, and I could have sworn you told me you were a rapist. And I went back and watched the episode. A racist. Okay.
Racist, yeah.
Different kind of bad.
It was an interesting show to work on. I mean, I don't know what David's experience was like, but what was the head writer's name?
David Kelly. David Kelly. David Milch.
Milch.
David Milch.
Okay. Now, David Milch, let me tell you something that you'll never hear anywhere else but here on
The Andy Troy Show.
This is what it's like to work for David Milch, okay, you guys? Now, tune in. I mean, again, my experience was different from him. So, you get a script, and you read it, and you show up on the set, and David Milch comes up to you and goes, "You're not going to say any of that. This is what you're going to say." And he tells you what you're going to say. Now, I'm talking scenes that are in television, 3 or 4 minutes is a long time. He tells you what you're going to say, and you either have to remember it or go write it down on a piece of paper. And then you get to another part of the scene and goes, hold on a second. He stops the director, and you're not going to say that either. This is what you're going to say. He thinks of it on the spot, and you have to memorize it on the spot. And I had a big part. And he did this the whole, 10 days I was on the shoot. And, I teach my actors all the time that acting is the meeting of a crisis and dealing with it, that you have to be ready for anything, anytime, anywhere, anyhow, and you still got to be able to do it.
Yeah, okay. Tom is right, because that has happened to me when David said, no, forget that. Say this. You're going to say this. And I was like, bewildered. But I've learned all this.
Yeah.
What do you mean? We're shooting.
He's a genius.
He creates it right there on the spot. That all goes. You say this. I'm telling you what you're going to say. You say it. And as an actor, as Tom said, he tells his young actors, you've got to be prepared for anything. You got to be prepared to be blindsided. You got to be prepared. So, okay, that's out of the window. I got to do this. And I was like, okay, no problem. You know what I mean? Let me get in the corner for like 2 minutes. You know what I mean? And learn these lines and come back. And then some director goes, "You ready?" "Yeah, I'm ready. Let's go."
Of course, Dennis Franz and Jimmy Smits were used to it. So they, they would look at me with compassion. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, this poor guy, because you're just a weekly
guest
artist. Yeah. But that was NYPD Blue. That was an interesting experience. And I've done tons of Law and Orders. Yeah.
Yeah, I remember you were like a correction lieutenant or something. I can't remember an episode.
I think I did 7 of them. One in which I slept with Marie. No, just kidding.
Marie Haggerty.
She slept with everyone.
Oh, God, Tom.
They don't know who it is. No, just kidding.
Now we're talking.
Her name really is
ratings.
I didn't say that, guys.
You heard it here first, folks. You'll probably never hear it again. So
I never said it. I'm doing, Tom can speak for himself. We do conventions because The Warriors is an international cult classic film. So we have fans from all over the world that are just fanatical fans that love this movie. And this weekend coming, I'm doing a show called The Big Apple Comic Con. And
Being produced by a good friend of mine, Michael Carbonara, who's a terrific promoter and producer. Yeah, I love that guy.
I believe I know him. He's like really into comic books.
Yes.
Involved in it when he was doing something around Halloween. Right?
Well, this week is...
You really know him. That's funny.
Yeah. So this week he has probably the biggest name in comic books. Stan Lee will be there. And, and he has me, Coach East, and Terry Michaels, who plays Vermin from the Warriors, will be there this weekend, Saturday, March 11th, Sunday, March 12th. So come out and meet us and greet us. You know what
you
I
know,
mean?
It was the guy I think you're talking about. I sold him my old comic books.
Did you really?
I'm serious. I had like X-Men 1
That's
and
him.
Like Daredevil 1 in the bottom of my drawer for 40 years, and I finally got him out of my house.
Wow.
My house, I could put stuff on the bottom of my closet now.
That's amazing. Yeah, Mike Carbonara, he's a terrific
Well, come
promoter.
Out and see us.
Yeah,
know.
Come
do
out
you,
and...
Do you know Nina Martinez by any chance?
No.
She works with him. She's a girl who's in my movie.
Oh. Well, come out and see us at the Big Apple Con, you know, this Saturday and Sunday. You know, there'll be other guest artists and, of course, Stan Lee. And, you know, we'll be there. We'll, you know, meet the fans and, you know, and all that sort of stuff. It'll be wonderful.
Good this show. Must be what it's like to do a porn movie where people are making noise in the
oh,
back.
Oh, don't remind me. It's been so long. It used to be. But anyway.
Yeah, it used to be long. Right. Now it's... It used to hit the ceiling. Now it's just... Yeah.
When I said I developed a limp, I meant something entirely different. But things have changed.
I have
anyway.
Floppy disk. Yeah.
Yeah. So you actually had an interesting an interesting Law and Order episode that I saw recently where you played a guy with, was it cerebral palsy?
Oh, yeah, cerebral palsy. He was a guy, and they did, it was the whole thing that they did with the syphilis thing back in the 40s, and right. They did this experiment with black men with syphilis and all that sort of stuff, and I played one of the people that the government used as human guinea pigs. Right. And all that. So it was a very, very interesting episode of it. You know, it's a great show, Law & Order. I mean, it's
how
was
it
23 years in the city?
I mean,
is it to convey
Marie.
That to the audience, that sort of serious physical disability?
Well, you know, as an actor, you know, you do your research, you study, and, you know, you play the character, you know who you're playing, and you get into the physicality of the character, and you go from there. You know, as an actor. And you become the character. You do your homework. Tom's an acting coach. He could explain that better than I.
Yes, explain that, Tom. We're all listening.
Well, you leave yourself. That's the key, is leaving yourself and getting into something bigger than you, something the greater good, right, is what Yeats called it. It's where you are subsumed by something more important than yourself, a character, so that, you know, the beauty of it is that you forget about yourself and all of your petty, trite, you know, complaints about life, and you become someone else for the benefit of serving a story. And by virtue of the fact that you do that, you're actually, you know, where acting as we know it started with the Greeks, the Dionysian theater, the Epidaurus was the first theater. These people that were chosen to be actors were, the word actor meant person of good morals.
Things change much?
Yeah, right. Well, I don't know. It's kind of ironic, isn't it? Because in many ways, if we didn't have people... Listen, there wouldn't be any unions if it weren't for the name actors standing up for us, like Tom Hanks and people like that, because the country is out to destroy all the unions. You know, I don't even want to get into the political nightmare that we're going through right now, but a lot of these very same people... liberal left-thinking people are the ones that are trying to fight for our... I know, that's boring, that's Dullesville. Nobody wants to hear about the fact that the poor are going to be hit with, you know, billions of dollars in health care costs so the rich can get just a little bit more rich. And nobody wants to hear about it because it's Dullesville, you know, that we're going to rape the environment and there isn't going to be any water, there isn't going to be any air, there isn't going to be any...
All I got to do is go on Facebook. I could hear whether I want to hear about it or not. It's there. There's plenty of talk about that.
Which is good. At least we're free to speak our minds.
At the moment. Because the free press is being trashed. Right. You know, the media is being trashed as fake and everything else.
Yep.
So, you know, I mean, where's the democracy? I mean, we don't live in some country where
the free press does not exist. You know what I mean?
This show. This show is the free press, folks.
Thank God.
So keep tuning in every week, and you'll get to hear something. Whatever.
Look for the truth. Look for the truth. Listen for the truth.
Now, is there any talk of a Warriors remake? Usually movies that are that successful end up getting done again, not necessarily as well, sometimes better.
There was one point where Tony Scott, the brother of Ridley Scott, had a script and was supposedly going to do a remake of The Warriors, but he passed away, and so I think that whole project is on hold. And I think a film like this, it's a classic, and there's certain films that you leave alone. And my personal opinion, The Warriors is a film that you leave alone. You don't try and make this a remake. There are certain films, to me, why would I ever try to remake The Godfather? Why would I ever try to remake On the Waterfront? I mean, there are certain movies that are so amazing that why, just leave it alone. If it's not broke, don't fix it. Do you know what I mean? I mean, that's my opinion on certain films.
Well, speaking of classics, I heard that The Warriors, to some degree, was inspired by West Side Story. Did you guys ever hear that?
No. It was inspired by a Greek tragedy. I can't remember the name of the play. It was Aeschylus. I think it was Aeschylus. It was, the Spartans had to fight their way back to their home turf. And they were outnumbered,
Was that like the 200?
Yeah, well, it's a book by Saul Yorick, who wrote this. And Walter,
I think... he took it from the Greek tragedy.
Yeah, he took it from that, and Walter adapted The Warriors from Saul's book. You know what I mean? About this army that was caught behind enemy lines and had to fight their way back.
Right.
You know what I mean? And that, I think that perhaps Walter took that premise and created...
Okay, maybe you can refute another rumor. I heard that Samuel L. Jackson was in The Warriors.
No, he was not in The Warriors.
He was an extra, wasn't he?
Was he? I don't know.
I think maybe he was.
Could be. I never saw him, so maybe he was. I don't know.
I think he was. I ran into him in an audition once, when he used to audition.
Okay.
And we were friendly, and he said, yeah, I was in that. He was in the conclave. He was an extra.
Oh, okay. It's
always interesting seeing people's face for 2 seconds. Like, William Dafoe was... in for 2 seconds when he was a kid in a movie called Shame featuring William Shatner as a KKK rabble rouser.
Oh my God.
If you want to see a bizarre movie, you got to get Shame. It's out there, it's available.
It's hysterical.
Yeah.
I was in the first Mickey Mouse movie.
Really?
You didn't see me, I was one of the mouses.
I hate mouses.
No, I'm just joking.
Is that how you got your nickname, Squeak?
Squeak? No, I'm Coachee. Squeak. Oh, I don't know. Nobody ever called me Squeak.
Well, they will after this show.
Oh, my God. I hope not. Just joking. I was not in the Mickey Mouse movie.
Well, Andy, thanks for having us. It's always good to be had.
Oh.
Well, it's always good to be wanted. But we had a great time, and it's a terrific show. And hey, you guys out there in La La Land, enjoy the show.
That's, you're talking about L.A. or just people in New York who were out of touch?
Well, back in the Rio, in the city, there's no place like the Big Apple.
So how'd they end up putting that song in the movie? It was a fun part of the end of the film. Kind of different than the rest of the music.
It is. I have no idea. They certainly didn't consult me.
What's the deal with that gal with the cool lips?
Lynn, she's a terrific person, God rest her soul. She passed away. Wonderful human being. She's done a lot of work.
Voice.
Yeah.
Now, she was, for the people who haven't seen it yet, the DJ in the film who kind of taunted you guys all the way back to Coney Island, my home turf.
And she gave clues to the other gangs as to where we were to try to... capture us, to trap us.
Right. I'm very proud that on that same beach, I filmed an African television show last year.
Is that right?
I somehow feel you look part African. Of the Warriors.
Yeah, well, and you look African.
You see all that, African blood there.
I don't even tan. Okay.
You're as white as a tuna fish. Thanks for having us.
Before we go, contact info one more time. How do we get a hold of you, Dave?
You can reach me at my website, www.daviddharris.com. That's my website.
And Tom, plug the acting
Do people still say TGW Acting Studio, thomasgwaits.com, the greatest acting school in the world, basically. I hate to say it, but it's true. And if you want to learn anything about acting, you stop over and see me.
I learned everything I know. Okay, me, andyfchoy@aol.com if you want to get a hold of me, or Andy Choi's Tasting NYC on Facebook, or follow us on YouTube. This great show will be up there soon, The Andy Choi Show. We will be back soon with more exciting programming. But for now, we are gone.